I'm a senior cloud engineer at PayPal. We're supposed to have Anand Palanasamy as well. He's probably going to show up any moment. But I'll go ahead and start. In this talk, we're going to try to share our experience with you in building the largest cloud in PayPal and probably the largest private cloud in the world. We're going to share our the challenge that we had to deal building this cloud, as well as some of the architecture, some what tools we use to build and manage this cloud. So I'm going to start with the introduction. First of all, I'm going to share with you some of the scale of OpenStack at PayPal. Currently, we have 100% of web and mid-tier running on OpenStack. Most of the dev and QA environment is also on running on OpenStack. We have about 10 plus, the summer is growing, availability zones with OpenStack. We have about 400,000 cores and about 82,000 VMs running OpenStack, all these KVM VMs. These numbers are actually growing every day as we build more and more infrastructure. The scale of the largest deployment, the largest PayPal cloud in PayPal is here are some of the numbers that we currently have. And in general, this cloud is probably 2.5 times larger than any other PayPal cloud AZs that we have with 120,000 cores. 4,600 projects and 4,300 users. We have about 800 images and 160 networks. That's in the specific IZ. Some of the cloud characteristics for this specific IZ, we are having multi-tenancy. We have multiple VPCs with policy-based segregation. We have hybrid networking with open vSwitch with both bridged and overlay networking. We have multiple cells. We also have multiple VM flavor families with the host aggregate-based separation. So the challenges that we had to deal in building this environment. So this environment, we started building this environment about a couple of months before we separated from eBay. So we had to quickly build that environment in order for our users to start deploying applications, migrate VMs from eBay, etc. So here are some of the challenges that we had to face. With first one is the aggressive deadline. As I mentioned, because of the separation, we had to build this environment. Here's Anand, he's joining. The first one was the aggressive deadline that we had to deal. Usually, the deadline was normal, because of the scale of this environment, it was. And we were under a lot of pressure. We had to deal with a lot more aggressive timeline. We had to use, for the first time, we had to use multi-cells. Because of the scale of this environment, we had to use multiple cells, mostly for availability and scalability. Another challenge that we had to deal with was the VM migration from eBay clouds. We had to migrate thousands of VMs from eBay, and this has to be done and very quickly. Another challenge that we had to deal was all the firewall rules that we have in place in PayPal. This, especially for this new AZ that we had to build, we had to probably deal with at least probably twice more as more firewall rules than usually, because we had to talk to legacy eBay sites, new PayPal sites, and etc. Another challenge that we had was hardware. Because we had fairly new hardware, there was no time to test well that hardware. We had a lot of issues related to hardware. For example, provisioning those hypervisors, it took us a lot of time because of the networking issues that we had to deal. For example, even the provisioning, when we had to pixie boot the hypervisors, for example, the second NIC when it was initiated by the BIOS was power cutting the first NIC, so basically the pixie was interrupted. So we had to deal with, we had to, in a timely fashion, to address these issues, talk to the vendors, find fixes, etc. Later on, we had, for example, storage controllers lockup that they also have to address quickly. For the architecture in this cloud environment, I'll let Anand talk about
it. Hello, everyone. Good evening. So, yeah. So basically, you know, the architecture itself, you know, very simple architecture when compared with any other cloud providers that we adopted for. So regions and sales and then availability zones. And within that AZ, actually, we have, you know, different varieties of our network architecture all the way from, you know, 10-year-old network architecture to, you know, the current generation network architecture. So, but what we did was actually we didn't take any shortcuts in terms of, you know, abstracting out, you know, all this, you know, different concept that whatever actually the users are dealing with, you know, cloud APIs, we just abstracted up all of them. So it's going to be just very simple for the end user. They don't even know whether we are running with, you know, VRF or we are running only the firewalls to separate out our security segments. So I'll just, you know, drill down into, you know, some of those, you know, our network overview point of view. So every rack actually, whatever we buy, it has four TAR switches, okay, active, and then active standby. And depends on the, you know, generation of the, you know, TAR switch that we buy. You know, some places actually we have, you know, VRF capabilities enabled, or some places actually, you know, just access switch. So nothing fancy. So in terms of, you know, the SDN itself, actually we took an approach where the same SDN controller supports both overlay as well as bridge. So wherever actually we have concerns about, you know, latency, you know, we don't really use, you know, overlay. We use only the bridge. But the idea is actually, you know, when we move along, once, you know, we are able to scale SDN controllers and then, you know, latency, whatever SDN controller that we are running today. So once it scales it out, then we are going to be moving every production workload into, you know, overlay. But currently, what we run is actually, you know, bridged to most of the, you know, mission critical workloads. But overlay for non-mission critical workloads, but they're also production. So where the latency is not that sensitive, right? But as I mentioned, actually, you know, we have LACP and then VRF, and some places actually we don't even have, you know, this kind of, you know, network switches. So, but, you know, we just, you know, used exactly, you know, the network infrastructure, whatever we built over the period of time, and then, you know, installed OpenStack on top of that. And, you know, we leveraged the existing firewalls and then load balancers. Being a secure, you know, a payments industry, we always care about, you know, the compliance and then security and stuff like that, but we can't get away from that. So I have, you know, one more talk tomorrow at 2 o'clock, and, you know, I have, you know, more detailed into, you know, how we separated out our VPCs and stuff like that. I'll talk about more about that. So if you guys are interested in, you can come in that. So and also, you know, as Kalin mentioned, we adapted multi-cell. The reason is actually, you know, we didn't want to build a giant availability zone just having just one control plane and one RabbitMQ cluster. Because of the scale issues that we ran into, so we separated out into, you know, eight racks around, you know, 800 hypervisors into a particular cell, so that actually you have you know, one particular small domain to manage the scale better. So today, actually, we have one of the largest ASEVDs around 2,500 hypervisors that we are running. It includes, you know, dev QA, production, non-production, and some external cloud, actually, people deploy some, you know, blog post and stuff like that. But all of them run in the same cloud, same availability zone. But if you look at, you know, the every security segment, actually, we call it as VPC. VPC, you know, it's very similar to, you know, what AWS has today, right? So, but the controller, it manages, is very same across the board. Whether we run production or non-production doesn't matter, but the security domain itself, it's being controlled by, you know, firewall, security rules, and then, you know, load balance is also being separated out. And one interesting thing actually in this whole thing is, you know, storage. So how we are going to be running a same storage cluster for, you know, storing your compliance, you know, files as well as non-compliance files were very critical for, you know, meeting PCI standards, right? So one thing actually what we haven't solved today is actually, you know, having the one cluster where you just store everything and then pull it out, because we have today one for compliance, one for non-compliance. And that's how actually we are deploying it today. But once we mature more and more, and we are looking at whether, you know, we can separate it out, the network itself in the same cluster, and then dynamically move the object files in and around where the same disk doesn't share, you know, sensitive data and non-sensitive data, right? So we don't deploy that way today. And we also got into, you know, some cell limitations, actually, lack of, you know, lot of issues. It's the first time we are deploying cells, and we ran into a lot of synchronization issues between your, you know, cell controllers and then your availability zone controllers, because availability zone manages more than one cell. And, you know, there are some data synchronization between cell and, you know, availability zone when the message got lost or whatever, then they don't sync back, actually. We have to, you know, manually do a lot of, you know, tweaking so that, you know, whatever data you have at the availability zone, you know, comprises of all three, you know, cells that we have, right? And again, you know, if you are running your, if you are expecting your controller to be running at 99.9, that's our, you know, expected goal that we wanted to run, where all our other layers sitting on top of our IIS layer, like, you know, PaaS or maybe ops tools, or there are, you know, a bunch of, you know, other automation being, you know, running on the IIS cloud, like, you know, your Mesos cluster, or, you know, we have, you know, some places, you know, CI itself running. And then our, you know, old QA environment, actually, we have built in a lot of automations around it so that actually we run our, you know, C infrastructure at scale for, you know, thousands of developers we have in the company. So our, you know, API is very much, you know, it's just given. So you can't just say, hey, API, we don't care actually 80%, and then, you know, you just go and run your, you know, data plane as long as it runs, it's fine, it's not about that. So you're trying to spin up, you know, 100 VMs. No, we expect 99 of them comes up at least, right? So it was not the case when we started. We were around 70%, right? We are definitely in high 90s today. But a lot of things actually what we put together in last three and a half years of learning, you know, how you can, you know, scale them up. At the same time, how you can make sure that they're always available. And, you know, we got into, you know, multi-master replications, and then, you know, WIP for, you know, failover persistence, you know, whatever actually you could, you know, you could take from the infrastructure side itself. Even though actually you could say, hey, I just don't need load balancers, but we are not there yet, right? So we got to put the load balancers, even one node goes down, actually the other one is taking over. And if you're running an active standby, making sure that actually, you know, you're running behind, you know, some kind of GTM, it automatically fails over another, to another database server. So whatever best practices we are, you know, adapting for our, you know, PayPal applications, we just adapted the same thing for running OpenStack also. It's nothing fancy, right? So, and also, you know, we run, you know, Galera clusters for our, you know, global keystone. We have multiple availability zone. I think, you know, Kalin talked about around 10 availability zone, and we don't want to have, you know, multiple keystone endpoints, right? So as a cloud user, you come in, you just talk to only one keystone endpoint, but it gives you back the catalog of, you know, the endpoints, so that actually you just go to one particular availability zone, you look up only that particular catalog, you just go back and then refer to that particular, you know, Nova, or maybe Neutron, or the load balancer as a service, or DNS, or whatever, right? So we put together every availability zone, but the end user perspective, actually, they just come and hit, you know, only one URL. But the problem for this is actually, you know, if you don't have something similar to GTM, you know, you'll be authenticating somewhere in East region, but your token will become, you know, go to somewhere in West. So what we did was actually, you know, we took the GTM, Global Traffic Manager. So if you're talking to, you know, one particular availability zone, we'll make sure that actually the keystone endpoint, you know, you go back to the same availability zone. You don't, you know, go back somewhere else and authenticate. But we synchronize the token across the board. So even that particular availability zone goes down, then the token is already replicated because the Clara cluster across the world actually, you know, we just, you know, replicate across the board, right? So Clara cluster was used only for the global global keystone today. And RabbitMQ, again, actually we run, you know, mirror queues, and the Neutron DHCP actually Corosync and Pacemaker for running HA, so that actually one of the, you know, the standby goes down, it automatically takes over. The active goes down, standby automatically takes over. And API endpoints we talked about, actually we run, you know, multi-controllers behind the load balancer whip, and even one controller goes down, actually, you know, others, you know, continue to, you know, work as it is, right? And we have, you know, ECV checks for them as well. And migration?
Yeah, you can do it.
Okay, so the migration was one of the, you know, recent pain that we went through. We had three different availability zones, and this, you know, migration was done for as part of the eBay and PayPal company split. So both, you know, eBay and PayPal developers, they shared the same, you know, dev VPC. Dev and QA was shared by, you know, both eBay and PayPal teams. So now we have to separate it out around 8,000 plus VMs, and then close to 2 petabyte of data. That's volume data, right? There are a bunch of, you know, local data as well in each and every VM that we had to migrate, right? So we literally had only 7 months, right? So the company announcement itself, actually, the entire split is around 7 to 8 months. And we did talk to multiple vendors, actually, hey, we wanted to migrate 8,000 plus VMs and also, you know, petabytes of data. Right, so they came up with, yeah, we did a lot of, you know, projects in the past, and you know, we migrated thousands of VMs, and we did ask actually how you guys did that. Yeah, so we have a tool, you have a source cloud, go and, you know, find your flavors, we created in the target. Then how did you migrate the data? Yeah, we work with the developers, and then they copy the data. So we put, you know, 10 or 15 people in the support team, and then they just go and help them. If the file system doesn't come up for whatever reasons, actually, you know, they had year and a half project actually to migrate 2,000 VMs, right? That's only just creating the VMs and supporting them. And they didn't talk about our volume data or maybe the object storage. So we got only 2 months literally, right? Because first of all, to move this, we didn't even have the cloud. First, we have to build that within 6 months. That's the largest AZ, around 2,500 hypervisors. We didn't even have a network part for that. Altogether, you know, completely new network circuit. And that itself took us, you know, 3 months to build it because this has, you know, a lot of complexity in it because of the, you know, the way that we are going to be running multiple VPCs there. We wanted to make sure that actually we are buying the network gears that supports VRF and all those things. We are also, you know, trying out new generations of network gears. So it took, you know, 3 months to build it. And then I think we are, you know, splitting it sometime in June or July. And we completed the build-out itself by April end. Anand, correct me if I'm wrong. April end. And we got 8 weeks, right? So no tools, okay? Vendors are asking for 1.5 years. So we wrote a tool called in a flyway. So what it does actually as a provider, you have access to the hypervisors. So you go and, you know, get all your, you know, source cloud flavors, create the VMs, and, you know, and after that, actually, you just turn it off, right? And copy the disk file all the way from source cloud to the target cloud. The problem was we had, you know, three different availabilities on three different regions. You have to copy all the disk files from three different locations, geographically distributed, you know, three different regions, literally. And we have to copy it to one location, right? A lot of, you know, network, network timeouts or, you know, the rsync itself fails, you know, we ran through a bunch of issues, actually. And also, you know, the disk file itself sometimes, you know, varies. Around 40 gig or 50 gig, sometimes people have, you know, 500 gig. How are you going to be copying the disk file, right? So the team did a fantastic job of, you know, creating that tool. And, you know, it's completely migrated within, you know, 8 to 10 weeks. So that's what actually we got it. And interestingly, we migrated so much of VMs. And when we bring it up, we have a lot of other issues as well. Because people might have used their own password or maybe, you know, the password itself different between, you know, two different companies now. And how they are, we are going to be making sure that actually they could log in back, right? So how securely you are going to be, you know, managing those keys and stuff like that. It's going to be very, very, you know, tricky. So it took us, you know, more time after the split, you know, supporting them actually, you know, in terms of, you know, how they can log in. If they cannot log in, actually, how we are going to be supporting them in terms of thousands of VMs. And he will say, hey, okay, VM is coming up, my application is not coming up. Whatever actually give us testing, it's not a standard application that we are running in our production site. You have, a standard pattern actually how the applications you can bring them back, because they might have tried some sample application, test application or whatever. And you have no clue about actually, you know, how you can, you know, bring that back. So a lot of hand-holding. So the building the tool is one thing, and then migrating this data. And when you bring it up, actually, they might have some post-install, and they may not even run, because they might be connecting to some IP address that are pointing to eBay, and you don't have access anymore there, and how you are going to be supporting it. And the LDAP itself might be pointing to, you know, different network, and you don't have access to that anymore, right? So a lot of, along the way, actually, we did some tooling also for that, actually, you know, how you can, you know, securely log into those and then identify what are the files that you need to touch and then go and modify them so that agile people could log in and then use it, right? So this is our, you know, very, very high level, you know, architecture, actually, you know, how the flyway works. So where, it is running in one particular, you know, availability zone, it is, you know, talking to multiple cloud, and it is posting the message, and then the file copy itself will take, you know, hours and hours. You want to wait for that, message to be back so that actually, you know, you can go back and update actually this particular tenant itself had, you know, hundreds of VMs, and then he migrated successfully. So because, you know, we don't want to, you know, run them and, just sit there for hours to update some status. So we exactly, you know, followed the same OpenStack architecture where, you know, completely loosely coupled. When the particular agent is done, it's going to, you know, post a message back saying that, okay, I'm done with my file copy. You know, you go and, you know, do, you know, other processing in the, whatever is in the next in the, you know, workflow. So the tool is being open sourced. And you guys could try it out, actually. It's in PayPal Git, right? PayPal Git. Yeah, it should be in the PayPal Git. So Kalin, this is one of the tools that we wrote for just for the migration. To run this many available zone, we have a bunch of other tools, actually, you know, that Kalin is going to be talking about.
Yes, basically, to build environment, we had to use a lot of tools. Some of these tools were open source tools. Some of the tools we had to build in-house because we had to customize, that could be customized for this environment. As I mentioned, that Flyway is one of the tools that we built in-house and we open source it. I'll start with some of the open source tools that we used. For provisioning, we used Cobbler. In general, it's Cobbler, but we have our own tools on top of Cobbler. I'm going to talk later. One of those tools that we use for provisioning. For configuration management, we use Puppet and Salt. Salt for mostly for orchestration. Puppet we use for config management of the systems as well as deploying OpenStack code. For monitoring, we use Zabbix. We've been using Zabbix for years, and we still continue using it. We're happy with it. For graphing, we're using Graphite. Some of the in-house tools that we built for cloud health and metrics, we use StackWatch and StackMetrics. I think I'll cover some of them later. But for cloud view, we use Cloud Info, for capacity reclamation, Cloud Minion. For server remediation and provisioning, we use Reparo. Actually, that's the tool that we use. Basically, we call Cobbler from it and to provision the bare metals. We also use CMS, which is also in-house. It's like a configuration management database that we store a lot of information, for example, assets, network information, application, and et cetera. So for cloud health and metrics, we use StackWatch and StackMetrics. StackWatch is basically it's like a continuous live testing of the cloud. Every 30 minutes, we create 10 VMs on that cloud. If there is a failure of one VM, we basically receive alert that something's going on. We also track all this data and use stack metrics to for graphing, basically to see in timeline all the issues. Basically, all this is deposited in a time series to graphite. And to visualize all this, we use Grafana. The clouded info is basically, it creates aggregated views of all cloud resources for that particular AZ. It aggregates data from multiple OpenStack databases and multiple database tables. It's also caching that information for a quicker viewing. It also provides metrics views, most through capacity related or views. For server remediation and provisioning, we use Reparo. Reparo is used for different purposes. One of them is automated onboarding of the hardware. It has continuous health monitoring of the bare metals. We can also use it for patching. We can patch the bare metals as well as the VMs to Reparo. It also it helps us to repair the bare metals, and if it also flags for human interaction if there's a problem with a specific server. And as recently we started using it also for provisioning, basically Reparo calls Cobbler, which in terms of through API, we do a bunch of power resets and we get information about the server, et cetera. For configuration database, we use CMS. CMS is also open source. It started at it was a project that was started at eBay, and we're using it. It's basically a database of all assets, physical and virtual. We store, as I mentioned, network information, application information, everything that can be stored by the infrastructure. For capacity reclamation, we use Cloud Minion. It's also in-house a tool that it's also open sourced. It identifies VMs on the cloud by examining the network traffic. And if it finds a VM that's it's unused, basically it flags it. It sets an expiration date. It notifies the user that the VM is unused, and the user then takes an action. If the user doesn't take an action, the VM is shut down and later deleted. And the user also is provided by a web GUI that can manage the expiration dates, sets, and basically the user decides whether to the VM is used or not. It also generates capacity reclamation reports. We also have ongoing projects after we build this environment. Now we have more time to for reliability and basically do more stuff on that this environment. We basically start working on several different projects, and I'll let Anand speak.
So far in the last 3.5 years, if you look at the team itself, you know, we're very, very thin team, and we've got more than 10 plus available DAOs, and most of them are mission critical available DAOs taking, you know, PayPal payments today, right? And that too, it's not just only the provisioning. Actually, we talk about, you know, in terms of the network reachability, and then, you know, not, you know, taking away the security, you know, zoning that we have in place, right? So within this whole boundary, you know, we just didn't build, completely a green greenhouse, and then move everything from the existing infrastructure into the new infrastructure, right? So one thing what we did was actually, you know, just take the existing infrastructure as it is, and, you know, use as it is, but just change only the provisioning system with OpenStack, right? That's how actually we were able to move both the needle, basically, and build the cloud at the same time, you know, migrate it as well. And also, you know, we didn't wait for every applications to be migrated to the, you know, cloud ready. Even today, actually, if you talk about a couple of VMs went down, and some applications still cream because, you know, their their capacity is going down. But in the cloud world, no one cares about two VMs, right? But some of the applications, you know, most of the applications already got migrated, but 3 years, 3.5 years back when you talk about, you know, hey, you build a cloud and people will migrate to it, but it's not going, it is going to be taking another 5 years that we didn't want to do it, right? And as part of this, actually, you know, if you look at, even though actually we say actually we are running one of the world's largest private cloud that is taking mission critical production workload, and we are not in, you know, we are not in KLON everywhere, right? So we are running Havana everywhere, but we are we already migrated an availability zone to Kilo, and we are going to be completely migrating all other availability zones also into Kilo. One important thing for this is because you can't just take down your API service because a lot of, you know, automation is built on top of that. You have to be really, really careful. Okay, when you're taking the downtime for this, if at all, you know, the API is going to, it's not going to be available because we are going to be adding a capacity for some reason during the peak. You can't just take like that, you know, take it out. So you have to wait for your own window within this mission critical, you know, operations cycle. Then you have to find your window and then take this, make sure that actually complete this upgrade. So that itself is a huge project actually whenever you upgrade, then it is going to be, you know, huge effort. But one good thing with, you know, after Kilo, it's going to be really better because we are going to be supporting live upgrade, right? So we are not going to take down the control plane, and you do whenever, you know, you are ready. And also, you know, we are not going to be doing every service in one window, right? So we are going to be taking, hey, I'm ready in Neutron, I'm just going to be upgrading only my own part. Okay, when you're ready, the Neutron team is going to be doing that. If everybody is going to be Nova, Nova is going to be doing that separately. So that is still a huge project. It's, you know, talking about in 10 different, you know, deployments, 10 different availability zones, and with, you know, cells as well, right? It's going to be very, very tricky, and without impacting, you know, other layers. So that is ongoing, and it continues to grow. And also, you know, we built, you know, a lot of automation also for, you know, migration itself, like, you know, complete CI, CD, and then running all your Tempest test cases or a bunch of other tests, making sure that actually, you know, nothing is breaking. And also, you know, we have our users also do the same testing before we, you know, wire it on, you know, all this, you know, new APIs that is going, that we wanted to make sure that they're not going to create any other problem. And we also have, you know, masterless Puppet. We ran into, you know, Puppet master scale issues, and we are moving away from the master, right? So we are not going to be running the master. That project, actually, Kalin is running it. It is going really, really well. And control Puppet runs on deployments because, you know, today, okay, you have a configuration. You change something in your Puppet module. We can't just like that say, hey, I checked it in. It is going to roll out everywhere. And if it is randomly deploying everywhere, and if there is an issue, then you can't just like that roll back. So what we do is actually, you know, we don't automatically deploy all this configuration, you know, configuration. So we make sure that actually we deploy it in 5% or 10%, verify everything is good, the new configuration, and then go and roll it out everywhere in the phased manner, right? So the completely controlled, you know, deployment, that's where actually we use Salt or maybe Ansible and all those things so that actually we can orchestrate this deployment over the period of time rather than being, I checked in, okay, it's automatically going to, you know, take it over. So then you could ask very well, okay, why are you running Puppet? Actually, that's the whole reason of running Puppet. You let it upgrade and then so that actually it's going to be, you know, all your configurations are going to be very, very, you know, up to date. But it also, it brought in a lot of other issues for us. We wanted to make sure that actually we have the control deployment. Once we are ready with all the CI pipeline, make sure that actually your code and then, you know, our Puppet module is going together, there is no difference in between these two, then we will automatically go and, you know, roll it out, but not at the expense of, you know, just taking down your production APIs, right? And also, you know, we are, you know, building an infrastructure AZ. So what does that mean? So to build a new availability zone today, so we are taking anywhere between 4 to 6 weeks, but we wanted to bring down to a week, right? So if you are building a new availability zone completely from all the way from scratch, the network pod is ready, and after that actually you want to bring in your new set of racks, and you wanted to have control plane also running in all those, you know, different racks so that actually, you know, you can build your ACS really, really fast within a week. So we are putting together a lot of effort to bring in, you know, there is a remote OC that is going to sit in, and it is going to build some other AC by using that information, whatever you have it there, right? And also, you know, it is going to be, you know, used by the containers project as well, so that, you know, we test our own control plane before even, you know, go and, you know, use Docker for our main production systems. So it's a small cluster, and we wanted to scale it out as well. So today, actually, if you have, you know, 10 VMs, for example, you know, your Nova is running behind 10 VMs, right? You wanted to scale it up automatically today because the load is going to increase. Today, we have to do it manually, but we wanted to auto-flux up that as well. Right, but the infra AZ is going to be a project. We made it as a project, and it is going to be, you know, solving most of these problems that we have today. and homegrown LBAS. So we built our own load balancer as a service that is running in both EB and PayPal today. And since they're all internally custom built APIs and completely RESTful API is managing both production systems today. But since we wanted to be in the community at the same time, we wanted to enable all our vendors to write the new capabilities as the the drivers and then plugins. We are moving away from our own, even though actually we put three to four years of effort and are completely matured, and we are moving away from our existing load balancer as a service into community LBAS. We are running our dev and QA VPC with LBAS, and then production is still running with our own version of LBAS, but the next year and a half, actually, we're going to be completely migrating into that. And config trip management, this is very important piece. Since we are not running Puppet, okay, automatically, so it is going to introduce some config root for you for sure, because when you deployed your code, one of your hypervisor might have been down, right? That it came back now, but it is going to completely have different set of code base. At the same time, the configuration is going to be different, right? So now how you are going to be managing this, right? Because turning off your Puppet master auto deployment is completely fine, but it is going to introduce some other problem. Right. So we are building a config trip management. So it is going to give you complete visibility into your infrastructure. How many hypervisors you have? What is your current configuration, including your BIOS version, or including your OS version? What's your kernel? And it will give you the whole view of your cloud deployment. Then it will be very useful for operations teams. They can go and just take an action on top of it. Actually, today, if you ask, actually, you have to go and collect a lot of statistics about it so that you know what's going on in your infrastructure. So this project is going to give us more visibility into our infrastructure, actually, what is in there. Yeah. So, and also, we have some more, this again, it's a masterless Puppet. So this masterless Puppet is going to have a control file. This control file is going to be used by every client in the hypervisors. And it will determine actually when to deploy and what version of the OpenStack code and what version of the configuration. So it is going to have that information into the file. So the infrastructure is, we already talked about it. Okay, what will it contain? It is again another OpenStack environment. It itself and it's OpenStack deployment. OpenStack and OpenStack, it's very much similar to that, right? And the cloud control plane on touch capacity. This one actually very, very key for us today. Okay, holiday is around the corner, and we want to add 30% of our capacity, what you are running in production, and of course, you are going to be buying more and more racks every year. So how much time you take to get your rack into your data center, and how soon actually you can get it into live? Because there are a whole lot of things actually needs to happen in this whole workflow and then pipeline, and we have a bunch of tools already built in, but still, we are not to the level where we wanted to be in. Basically, we want to do it within a within 1 or 2 days of getting the rack into the data center, but it takes a week today, right? You wanted to bring down that to 2 days, so that actually you are maximizing your investment, because you have your hardware life cycle of 3 to 4 years. Every day that you are going to lose, you are losing the money. So you wanted to definitely bring it down to day of deployment, whenever it reaches the dock, and from the dock to the floor, and how many tests that you could run. And how many configurations you have, switches or hypervisors, how soon actually you can deploy all of this, different software and different tools that you wanted to run in, you want to run your hypervisors. How fast actually you could deploy and then verify, and then add it to your existing capacity, right? So there are a bunch of things need to happen from all the way from your dock to your floor. So there is another project going on, and it is going on for a long time, and it is basically optimizing this whole workflow. And introducing more and more efficiency to this workflow. So, what is the other one? Okay, now time for questions. Yeah.
How big is your OpenStack
team? Yeah. So close to 30. Yeah. We started with one engineer. I think I'm going to be talking about that more, the whole journey. But we are around 22 engineers, and then 8 are operations teams. Very, very slim team. So that's one of the reasons. If you look at actually, we don't have a lot of contributions to the community. But once we have the live upgrade and then entire CI pipeline, everything is set up, and if you are going to be in live upgrade mode, and you just free up yourself to be in the community, right?
Yeah, so just operations is 10 people, and 20 is dev.
Yes, sir.
Are you using the Puppet OpenStack modules or some other form?
Yeah, so that one actually was a very interesting piece. So we started with that, right? But we deviated from that for a reason because our deployment topology is something different from what the vanilla one has. At the same time, we wanted to preserve our passwords and stuff like that in encrypted mode, and we wanted to have more control over Puppet modules. That's one reason. And another one, actually, we wanted to have every component as a separate module that we recently refactored completely, where whenever you deploy Neutron, we have to pull the entire tree and then go and deploy it earlier. And you don't know what other people changed. You are going to pull in some unknown changes you are going to be deploying. That introduced some more issues as well in the past. So we refactored it recently as part of the kilo upgrade. So I think if we have time, actually, we are planning to open source this as well. But the time is really, really too short for us. Managing 10 plus availability zone. Yeah, so that's what actually we should do that, actually. Yeah, we'll plan for it for sure. Yeah,
tripped. You're in housing that. So you listed both Puppet and Salt, but
yeah.
You're using Salt as an orchestration.
Yeah, orchestration.
Yes, so basically currently we use Sol for orchestration, which Sol basically calls Puppet to run control Puppet runs. But we're switching away from that model. We're basically creating a YAML file, control file, which basically is going to be pulled by each client, example, each hypervisor. And basically that control file is going to tell the client whether to run Puppet or not. And basically that way it got a timestamp that you can ensure that everything is up to date. Yeah, so basically Salt by itself has issues, especially on the large scale, especially that the round that we currently have. We like Salt, we use it, but for config management drifts, to ensure that everything is running on time, we have to switch to Masterless Puppet first of all. For example, we have to upgrade to Kilo, we have to quickly upgrade all the hypervisors that we have. And basically, to control that, we plan not to use Salt to trigger the runs, but basically have this control file, which is going to be pulled by each client, and then. Yeah, this is what we're currently working on. It will probably be in working condition very soon. Yeah.
You guys want to take it offline, maybe, I think, the next hour. So one more question. Yeah.
What sort of resource recommendation do you see for
how many? So you want to talk about that? How many dollars that you saved?
So I talked during the last summit. When we initially deployed it, we found 40% of the VMs as unused.
Oh, so that's in dev key, actually.
This is just on the self-service belt. Yeah. Part.
But production VPCs, actually, we have capacity team, and they need to manage our site capacity and stuff like that. That's totally different. Yeah. Anything else? OK, thank you. Oh, one more. Too early. So what version of Salt that you're running?
Storage.
Oh, OK. So we have both volumes and then object storage. Volume, actually, we have SolidFire at the back end today. And we are using Cinder. That's one of the largest use case we have for dev QA. And then production also we rolled out recently for code deployments. And for the Swift, actually, PayPal doesn't have a lot of use cases for object storage. We store a lot of tens of thousands of images. But we have significant usages that is increasing, and we are going to be increasing our Swift cluster size also. So it is already on the way. Yep. Anything else? OK, thank you.